Joining me now, Peter Orszag, former director of the Congressional Budget Office and director of the Office of Management and Budget under President Obama, and Douglas Holtz Aiken, former director of the CBO during the Bush administration. Gentlemen, welcome. So we get this budget deal. Can we all sort of agree, stipulate at the top that this was more driven by politics than policy? They needed to have a budget deal.
So stipulated.
So stipulated. Okay. So when you look at this budget, what is right with it?
Well, I think what's right with it is it gets the basic construct of what we should be doing correct, which is we should do a little bit less deficit reduction today and a little bit more out over time. That's what this does. So that's a good thing. But I think the most important part of this deal is it just, for the first time in several years, signals that maybe Washington won't be so dysfunctional for a period of 12 to 14 months and will let the economy gain some momentum.
Such an optimist.
I think there are three things. Number one, I'm going to agree with Peter. This is addition by subtraction. You don't shut the government and pay the penalty that comes with that. You don't scare American consumers and hurt the economy. It's a big and an important move. Second is, I don't care if you're a big defense or small defense person, it makes no sense to cut it by $19 billion in January and then turn around and put $23 billion back in over the next 3 years. That's pointless. So it fixes that. And then the third is it changes the focus, not in a dramatic way, but in a tiny way, from the annual spending by Congress to the permanent programs that are really driving the spending and the budget problems. That's a step in the right direction.
So in other words, to deal with Medicare, to deal with Medicaid, to deal with Social Security, which many people say that's what's really driving our long-term problems, they now have sort of put aside the short-term problems, which is what's the budget going to be for the next year, right, and have room in their schedules to deal with the long-term problems.
Absolutely. And among those long-term problems are pensions. They didn't take on Social Security, the largest and most important pension program, but they touched some of the others in little ways, and it's a step in the right direction.
But the big news in that the rest of that budget is Medicare costs have slowed down dramatically. In fact, the first 2 months of this fiscal year, Medicare costs were down even in nominal terms relative to the previous year. We have a revolution going on in the health sector that could, if it's continued, have massive consequences. And everything you think you know about the long-term fiscal gap would be wrong if this were to continue.
And that is the result of the lowering of Medicare costs.
Multiple things. I think the biggest thing is the expectation that we're moving away from fee-for-service payment. And most hospital executives think we're moving quickly. The key is we need to realize those expectations, or everything that people are doing in advance of that shift would be dropped.
Unless, of course, it turns out the health care.
So the most important thing Peter said were if is the key here. We don't know yet. And we can't fully diagnose what's gone on. It's happened, and it's a cause for hope. No more.
Let me get back to one of the things I think both of you did agree on, and that is that this is a good signal for the business community. We are told, hey, we've got a plan. You don't have to lay awake at night trying to figure out what the government is going to do to screw up your daily life. We've got this plan. The idea being, I think, that businesses that have been sitting on huge amounts of money will now go, okay, let's hire people.
Yet. This is good. As I said, this doesn't get in the way. But there's some things out there that could finish this off and really make it much more powerful. Immigration reform is not yet complete. Speaker Boehner said he's going to take this up in the House. He's going to lead that effort. That would be a good thing to get done. That's a permanent reform that changes the landscape. Tax reform is the same way. Permanent change gives some stability, allows our corporations to compete around the world. We need to get those things done. That's what I'd look for presidential leadership on in 2014. If we get those, we'll have a big success.
Well, the other thing we need is to make sure that the debt limit coming up in the spring is a non-event, and I hope it will be. But with that, I think we may be in for a decent, not a great, but a decent 2014, because the non-federal sectors of the economy are actually growing at north of 3%. If the federal government just kind of gets out of the way, 2014 will be better than 2013 was.
So you think that this will not necessarily say to businesses, we've got our act together a little bit, you can hire people?
I don't think it's that big a signal yet. And I would hope that we get the kinds of permanent reforms we need. We get the tax reforms, the immigration reforms, the entitlement reforms. That's too much for 2014, but we need to go that direction, because right now we're growing at about 2%. A little bit faster, maybe.
Which isn't great, right?
And that's
it's
not,
better
that's
than not,
not
growing.
That's right. Not fast enough. We still have to grow much faster to take all the workers who've given up, all the workers who've been long-term unemployed, and get them back to work. That's the top priority.
Will this budget deal by itself help the economy? help? Will this filter into a suburb somewhere in Pittsburgh?
A teeny amount. I mean, the bigger thing here, again, is that I think it gives it a little bit of, even without immigration reform and other things, a little bit of a sense of, oh, we're not going to have yet more drama and debacles out of Washington. So the biggest thing is not what's contained within the four corners. It's the symbolism. We have not shot ourselves in the foot.
Yay.
Economic policy making by symbolism is not a powerful thing. That's where we are.
Okay. But we've got it. It's better than nothing.
Exactly.
So let me ask you about long-term unemployment benefits, which were part of the stimulus package. We still have a huge long-term unemployment problem. I think you would both agree. If it is not extended, and it has to be extended by the end of this month, those weeks of unemployment benefits will go away for a lot of people, millions of people. What's going to be the net effect? Obviously, the net effect on those who won't get their unemployment benefits is one thing, and it's hard. What about the net effect on the economy? Because people always argue, oh, no, this is money that goes quickly into the economy, so it's good.
And I think that, look, the Congressional Budget Office, which we both had run, found exactly that when the economy is weak and when you need additional demand, which we're still in a situation where that holds, unemployment benefits are one of the most effective ways of getting money into the economy quickly. I think it's unfortunate that we're not extending that program.
This is a big deal for those on the program. It's not that big a deal for the economy. The CBO put it at about 300,000 jobs. That should be a month's worth of jobs. It's probably 2 months right now. But I think what it should focus attention on is the fact that long-term unemployment insurance is now trying to be all things to everybody. It's supposed to be unemployment insurance, something between jobs, a place to get income support during job training, and now it's also turned
not
into an anti-poverty
income
program.
Right.
Yeah, so this is mission drift. We have a big problem with the training. We have a big problem with unemployment. We need programs that match those problems.
Well, I agree with that, except that unemployment is still really elevated, and we've always provided these kinds of
seven.
And the long-term unemployment is almost 2.5%. I mean, the point is, we have always extended these benefits when unemployment is really elevated, both to help the workers themselves and also, look, 300,000 jobs is not nothing. I'd take it.
I want to show you all a poll that came out this week. It's an NBC Wall Street Journal poll. The question was, which party does a better job with the economy? What's happened since February is that Democrats have fallen. Right now, only 26% responded Democrats do a better job. 36% say, no, it's Republicans.
What happened to the
Who's right?
The 40%.
Were the other people going, I don't know. None of them seem very good at it. or what are you talking
that's
about?
That's the highest share.
But the fact is, look at that drop. I mean, my question to you is that correct? Are Republicans better at dealing with the economy?
Look, the party in power gets credit or blame for what goes on. This is a terrible recovery. The Democrats are paying for it. They haven't tried anything new in quite a while, so the message is old and stale. Republicans have tried something new. They made a budget deal, and they're not shutting the government.
You don't agree, I know.
No, look, the fact of the matter, again, I come back, 2014, I think, is likely for the first time in several years to be materially, not as strong as we'd like, but better than 2013. I think a lot of those numbers are going to change as the reality
and they,
does.
And they do kind of change with the economy, right, as we see. Thank you both so much, Peter Ozak. Douglas Holt-Aiken, we appreciate it.
Thanks for having me.